my channel. My name is Brittany Simon, and this is my brother Mark. And in today's video, we're trying two forms of audio, so hopefully one of them works. Okay, so in today's...
What are we talking about?
Well, okay, so in today's video, what we wanted to talk about was we were watching Queer Eye and completely just going down the soldier road of gayness. And since it's Pride Month and we're finishing up the month of June, I just thought, fuck it, why don't we have Mark on?
Yeah.
We'll talk about being gay, maybe tell some stories, but Queer Eye specifically is my favorite group of number twos changing the world. Like, 10 on the attraction scale for most of them, but 2 in terms of my philosophy levels, meaning that they're like many people in the world who are living in bubbles and finding ways to be themselves within those bubbles.
And help people
and
along the way.
People. So, Mark actually got me into this generation's Queer Eye because I grew up in the, you know, the 2000s era of Queer Eye, which I was watching in high school.
Which I've never seen.
Which is crazy because when I was watching it, my mom didn't know they were showing us gay stuff, and I was in fashion class,
oh, no.
You know, and I got a chance to see, like, gay people just being gay and then helping straight people out. And I was like, oh, this is everything.
And the straight people are okay with it.
Totally
that's,
chill.
That's a big thing.
But I remember when I was younger, I don't recall any female people they helped. So in my head, I always thought it was always men. But in this new Queer Eye, and I could be wrong, but in this new, about the old one, but in this new Queer Eye, they're helping everybody.
Yeah, men, women, gay, straight, whatever.
Cis, trans, it's
yeah,
just crazy. Everybody.
Everyone.
Well, okay, question, how did you find it? Why did you start watching it?
I think I was looking up videos of internalized homophobia because I was going through some shit. And Netflix. It was an ad because I was watching that. I was watching this movie Boys on the Band, and
great.
Then Netflix showed it on my queue like an advertisement or something, and I was like, "What is
you
that?
Have Indiana hair right here. Just get it off. It's driving me crazy. He has a dog, and I have a cat, and both of them just like to gift us with hair clumps all over us. But yeah, okay, that makes total sense. Actually, we were talking about that, like watching how queer they are in a lot of ways, like queer, especially Jonathan. But the thing that's really interesting about it is that it's also just like who he is in many ways.
Yeah, I mean, that's just who he, like from the beginning, that's who he's always been, or that's who the personality he ended up choosing.
Both. I think people who go into TV or YouTube or whatever, I think the healthy thing is to enhance what you already know about yourself.
Yeah. Oh, he did say when he was like 4 years old or whatever, he was always like that. So everyone already knew he was some type of queerness.
Yes.
Just like me.
Well, and I think it's an energy thing. Like, I do think you meet people and you're like, well, that whole idea of gaydar was always so funny to me when I was younger. Because with girls, I was like, I can't tell. But now I feel like I have a really good reading on people's energy.
It's still not good.
Really?
Well, yeah, it's still not good. Well, maybe.
For you? About
like
men or women?
Or both?
Both,
dude.
Really?
I have no idea. I don't think I've been around enough gay people to know, but... For example, the only reason when you said that, I think of back in high school, you know, the glance closet classroom, the only gay kids in the whole place, we know, we can like read each other's minds. I was fucking right. So I ended up being right about him being gay. We never talked about it, but
yeah.
Stuff like that.
So
like,
you do know, so you have something.
But like in today...
Well, today everyone is so queer, even if they don't want to be.
I'm not as good as you are at reading people, though. Because I haven't met a lot of people. But
That's true.
You've just met so many people that you know, like, oh, this is probably the type of person you are. But it takes me a minute.
That is true. I was traveling on my road trip, and I was somewhere, and I told my friend, I was like, I think this is a homosexual serving us lunch. And she and they were just like, oh, really? How do you know? I was like, something about her energy tells me she's a lesbian.
Yeah.
And I asked, I was like, are you a queer? And she was like, oh, my God, I am. Thank you. Like, you could just tell small town, finally being seen. But
yeah.
I whispered it in case. I was like,
oh,
you're homosexual. And so, like, it's just nice to be seen sometimes, but at the same time, I know as I get older, it becomes, my queerness is just not my focal identity anymore. My focal identity is just, like, my personhood, my womanhood, my maybe future motherhood. So for you, how has your journey been in your gayness, you know, after witching Queer Eye and enveloping yourself back in gay culture? We're going to go to Pride. We're going to have all these moments.
Yeah, I'm excited about that.
You know what I mean? How has it been for you? Is your gayness now the focal of your energy still, or how do you feel about it?
No, but it's there now. Mm-hmm. Like, I used to just shove it down, I guess you could say, but see, it's so weird because when I was living with you in Seattle when I was a kid, like 14, or even when I found out I like boys in like fourth grade, I always was okay with it and loved it and didn't even have, I don't think I even experienced internalized homophobia until I got older, which is, I feel like the opposite. Everyone else I've heard about keeps it a secret for like their whole life or something and hates themselves forever, but I hated myself when I got older.
What
past high school, I think. no idea. Maybe it's how we were raised or something, and now those voices were just kind of coming back when I ditched the family. Mm-hmm. And maybe those, like, what I was told as a child. My parents are very different now, obviously. But back then, the words hurt.
Yeah.
Now I don't care, but, like, back then I think maybe I didn't process them or something, or I just kind of, like, thought they were stupid, and then it really, like, took root in me later.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know why. I just can't explain it. And then all of a sudden I was, like, all of a sudden I was, like, insecure of people knowing I was gay, or... Mm-hmm. I was always known as the gay person everywhere I've worked, every job. I'm always, oh, that's Mark, or Mark is the gay one. And I was like, that's great, but, like, I wouldn't care as much today if I'm known as the gay one, which I am at my work.
You know what it is? Here's
but
what
back
I
then I felt like a target, because I just wasn't ready to talk about it or anything, but people would ask me, and I was so uncomfortable, because I was like, you know, it's just, because some people would say, like, okay, I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
If someone, two people are best friends, and one of the best friends thinks the other one is gay, and all they want is for the other, like, to know the gay friend, like, just be okay telling me, like, I want to tell them, I know you're gay, or just ask them, are you gay? Some people would say, no, like, respect it and let them take their time to come out to you, or would you just be like, bruh, are you gay? Bruh.
It depends, because, like, when you were younger, I was too busy worrying about my own coming out stuff to even think about, like, you being gay, and plus you being gay meant that I was going to get blamed for it in some way,
because,
you know, that's the favorite there.
Of course.
So, when you came out to me, I was just like, okay, this makes sense.
Which was insane, by the way. Did they know that story? Something?
I don't think so.
Well, Brittany was like, I really wanted to tell Brittany because I knew I would be more comfortable telling her than anybody else, even though everyone already knew before I knew, but, So Brittany's like, I'm gonna go to the store to get some milk. Well, you've not changed. You just always need a restock on milk. But I was like, I wanna go with you! And I did, and on the way there, it's like a 10-minute drive or something, but I just couldn't even say the words, like, repeating it in my head over and over. I was like, why can't I say it? And in the mirror, I couldn't even say it. I'm gay. Like, I just couldn't say it. And then I just said it to Brittany. What did you say? Did you say I know or something?
No, I think I don't remember what I said, to be honest. I remember being there. Like, I can imagine what we were doing sitting in
the
car.
And,
like, we had parked, right? Before you said it, didn't we park?
I think that was right before we parked.
Right before we
were at
parked.
A light, and I was like, I'm gay, or something.
And it was just like, you said it, and I was just like, oh. And in my head, you know, I think of everything, but I'm like, oh, he's at home. And then I'm thinking, like, oh, I'm not at home, because I was visiting.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Oh, probably.
Because I was 21, I had come, and so I had already come out and then come home.
Yeah.
So we had gone over that hump of me coming out.
Maybe that's why I was like, I have to tell her now, because she's going to go home. And
Yeah, because I wasn't living there at the time. I think I was in San Diego at the time, and I was visiting mom and dad.
Mm-hmm.
But I just remember feeling
like... San Diego, is that okay?
Yeah, they know I used to live in SD. Yeah, I used to live in San Diego, in Hillcrest, boo, the gay part of town. Hello,
oh,
by Balboa Park. So yeah, I think it was just... reassuring, and also, of course, worrisome, because we were dealing with a lot of homophobia at home, and just, like, a lot of challenges where our parents just had a hard time with it. Keep in mind that our parents, it's so weird now, because in hindsight, I understand that our parents were worried about us.
Yeah.
They weren't actually judging. They were judging, but they were like, you could go to hell.
Like, they've seen, like, gay people, like, just killed in the street by Saddam Hussein.
They've seen, like, horrible things happen to gay people, or worse, the gay people that they might have known about at the time were really just pedophiles who happened to be gay.
Mm-hmm.
So their only understanding of gayness was bad in every capacity. So you can imagine their kids coming out as gay was like, okay, hold up. Are our kids...
Even though they had to know.
You know, they do. I think they did know. I think they knew when you were young. I know mom used to say things all the time to me. If Mark turns out gay, this is your fault. And I'm like, okay, well, first of all, he's like 7, so.
Well, like, everyone knew when mom was 5. No, 4, probably, because,
You just had an energy to you. I think mom
is
magical. I think she feels energy. I think she knows things.
Because
mom, like, she just knows. She looks at you, she goes, something's going on.
Oh, I know. It's
like, that's just how mom is. But she is so, like, in her world of Catholicism, which is fine. But because of that, she just has a hard time imagining a world in which her God isn't real, and therefore... Because you have to remember, our parents are traditional religious humans who come from, like, ancient civilization in Iraq, where their religion was their savior. Like, their religion was their liberation, as well as the reason they were discriminated against. But the thing that was powerful was that they always had their faith in God. So you can imagine immigrants who come to this country fighting a war, you know, escaping death, they're going to give credit to the thing that saved them, and the idea that the thing they saved them could not be real, because of us. Oh my god, I look so tall right now in this video.
I know, because I sat a different way because my blood flow was stopped.
Also, bad circulation. They know during my podcast, I am always switching around. But
I didn't even
notice,
and I was like, this
even
is gonna...
if I'm in, it doesn't matter where I'm sitting. Even if I'm in a normal chair, I'm always constantly having to move my legs. Even when I'm sleeping, I hate it. Anyway, bad circulation.
Stretch more.
So I am curious though, like, do you think that there was a time where you experienced more internalized homophobia too? Because there's so much pressure from both gay communities and straight communities to be a certain kind of gay.
Yes, I've been called a horrible gay by other gay people a lot of times because I don't know people's names or pop culture. And
you're not a cultural gay.
Not knowing pop culture isn't an internalized homophobia thing. I just don't care about Ariana Grande and stuff.
A lot of people don't. I said it. I do not care anything about her personally. Sorry.
But I think you guys should know, I because I had a huge self-hate issue, separate from internalized homophobia, because I was just been a shitty person before, and I don't know if that was mixing in with internalized homophobia, because...
Maybe.
Because, you know, I said I didn't mind being gay, I loved it at first when I was little, and then I grew up and then messed up a few things, and then... hated myself in like a lot of different ways.
Do you think because your identity is you also are a gay man, so like anytime you think you're the monster, you think your gayness is the monster?
No.
Okay.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I haven't really thought about it.
Because I'll tell you, like, my biggest, like, I was thinking about, somebody was asking me about my insecurities the other day, and my the biggest insecurity I have is whether or not, like, I'm the monster in the story, right? That's always like a big fear of mine, because we've all been, like, we've all done things that maybe haven't been the greatest. And so I think I sit there and I think to myself, but I don't associate it also with my gayness, but I do associate me hurting people with my gayness.
Interesting.
Because coming out hurt people.
Yes.
You know?
I do feel like that, like come on, someone's out to get me type of thing. That's why I didn't like telling people a lot because, I don't know, when I was little, so I broke back down. Awesome movie. But I was scared, like, something like that would happen.
For sure.
But I've also been, like... ditched by all my friends and coworkers and stuff for being gay before, so that's probably why.
Yeah. Well, the worst part is that I really have seen in my lifetime, like, even my gay friends, so when I came out in San Diego and I was gay and I was going to all those pride parades with all my gay friends at the time, they were really upset that I was a Republican, but they still, like, understood me because they worked for Republicans, or they, like, you know, pretended to be Republicans in real life for their jobs but weren't privately, so they got it. And they embraced me, and it didn't feel like, I felt like I had a community, like a real community of people.
That's
cool. But when I got older and went to Seattle, and I was like a leftist, and then I started to show off more of my conservative side, they were like even now, people feel like, hey, if you're gay, you have to follow every, like, pro-gay policy, but I'm gonna be real, like, my gayness is just, it's so a part of me, it's a big part of me, but it's, I don't really feel, like, I don't want other people's lives to be impacted because of my life.
Yeah, it's kind of like Jonathan Van Ness was saying from Queer Eye, was saying in certain places, depending where you are, it does kind of, it's interesting that if he was his normal feminine self, he would make his whole family a target. So it's kind of like...
Yeah, see, that. Okay, maybe
scary.
Okay.
Or like if I were wearing colorful clothes or pink, I would feel like my whole, everyone's looking at me and my family, like, what is that family letting that kid do that for?
No, yeah. Well, okay, even with my own job, I think about my family constantly because I'm trying to protect them now. When I was bitter and angry at them, I didn't give a fuck. Mm-hmm. But that was wrong.
Yeah.
Ultimately, that is not ethical. And so now I'm considering the feelings of my family, and in turn, they're considering my feelings. Like, you know, we consider each other's feelings differently now, but I think it comes from, like, if you think you're the bigger person and the better person, then you better act like it. If you think people are bad for discriminating, or you think people are bad for being anti-gay, then you can't turn around and be anti-religion or anti-other people's choices. Because it just doesn't make sense to me personally.
Yeah.
Do I believe in ultimate freedom overall? Yes, but I'm also, like, pro-legalizing all drugs and getting everyone out of prison who doesn't need to be there. Yep. Mm. I don't think the government has the right to tell you not to do stuff.
I've never thought about it too much.
You know, because all I ultimately want is that people have the right to live their life how they want. And if something bad happens, we can have a community conversation after. But the reality is that laws are, in my opinion, blocking us from even thinking about the possibilities of more.
Well, it's also kind of like with the drug problem, maybe. I would feel a little questionable. Like, these drugs, like, if you're an adult selling this drug to another adult, that other adult can easily be giving it to a bunch of kids. And I kind of think about that sometimes. I'm like, interesting.
Yeah.
But if like, it's illegal, it's not gonna
okay,
stop.
Hold on. I make erotic art. Am I assuming when I sell it to an adult, they're going to go show children?
Okay.
Like,
I get it.
At the end of the day, we can't be held accountable for the actions of other people. We're held accountable for our actions. Hmm. You must move within your values and move forward. Because, yeah. Look, if we're always paranoid about, oh, somebody might do this, somebody might do this, isn't that the same reason people said not to allow gay marriage? Because if gay marriage happens, poly's going to happen, which is happening. And if that happens, platonic friends are going to get married, which is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I hate to say it, but, like, every humans as a species, we want more. We always do more.
Oh, yeah.
Which is why I'm anti-glutton, which is why I always say stop over-consuming things. Just because
yeah.
you can do it doesn't mean you should. Just because it's legal doesn't mean you should do it. We should teach self-restraint and power instead of giving into our instincts and into our gluttony.
That.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's how it feels with gayness, too. Like, we watched this one episode of Queer Eye that cracked me up about this, like, trans guy, right? Was he the one with the gay apartment? When you walk in, he just wants it to be really gay.
Everything was rainbows and... Like gay sex pictures all over the wall.
And it was obviously a young 20-something's apartment. Like, you could tell they didn't have the best furniture.
That's exactly what Bobby said. He's like, or they said, I just feel like I walked into someone who just discovered the gay world and came out. And now everything is gay, 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 gay. Which I felt that a lot. I've never acted on it. But I felt it. Like, like, you know, wearing colorful things or having a little, like, gay photo in my house.
Mm-hmm.
That's the extent of what I've done. But it does make me feel good having those things in my place.
Mm-hmm.
Just because, you know...
It's not your style. Because here's the thing. Gay culture does push a style onto us.
It's just I have a lot of styles and things I like. I just don't want it all to be one of anything.
Right. Which is why every room in my house is a different thing.
Yeah.
Because, like, I have to have it all. I'm an eclectic collector of just, like, feelings and vibes.
Oh, my gosh.
No,
it's like
sure.
on Howl's Moving Castle, Howl's room. How I have
my
stuff.
Gosh,
this is where your room is. But on a much smaller scale.
Thank you. But... Listen, overall, I think, like, things like Queer Eye are so important for representation.
Yes.
Because they are helping people. They're opening minds. But keep in mind, all the people they help have to be open to being helped.
Yeah.
So you can't just go around pretending you're Queer Eye people and saving the world, because it's not going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But they need to be open to it. And I think shows like this are super helpful. Plus, the guys are very relatable, and all of them are actually well-versed in their fields. They're not, like, fake.
Yeah.
Like,
Caramo. He's, over a decade of being a...
He 12 years a social worker.
A social worker
huge
and
deal.
Psychotherapist.
And psychotherapist. So, like, you're sitting here and you're like, okay, now I'm doubly impressed, right? Because you're not just some personality.
Yeah, Jonathan's, you know, been cutting hair way over a decade.
Mm-hmm. And he's great. Like, he's great with his haircut. They transform these people.
Yeah.
The decoration to the fashion choices from Tan. Like, everything is really well done. And I think that's important. When you're creating this and you're going to be the, sadly, like, the pressure on these guys is a lot because they are representing, like, gay culture in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
We watched a couple of Good Morning America, like, interviews. And you know me with Good Morning, it's so fucking number two fake to me. Like, oh my God, tell me, how does it work being the designer? It's like the way they talk is so fake.
It's pretty funny.
But it's also necessary because
I just like watching Queer Eye talk because they're not as...
Exactly. No, 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 no.
Scripted.
Well, that's why people watch. Sometimes we hate the interviewers, but we love the interviewees.
Yes.
And so the issue I have is that in the world of the two, since you're selling to the masses, you do have to put on that very... Even when talking about tragedy, they're like, did you know? 64, da-da-da. Like, they have to say it. Like, they go a little more serious, yes?
Yeah, it's like a joke how news people talk. Like, everyone on the news or the weatherman's like, looks like we have a sunny day. Like, shit like that. And people, you know, I think on How I Met Your Mother, they make a joke, Robin Scherbatsky.
Yeah. Look, there's a spectrum of how we socialize. And here on this channel, right, even me, there is a persona that comes out. I just like to think it's an amplified version of myself. Like, I don't want to bring grumpy Brittany to a video.
Oh, I was like, you're always like this, but yeah,
no, you know what I mean, though.
I know what you
I have grumpy modes. I have like modes where I'm like more serious, and I put on my mark. Now we're not fucking around.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not fucking joking.
Yeah, it feels bad.
It's like a cloud comes over the room. It's like listen to me.
Yeah.
Do you feel like just discussing gayness? Because over the years, you know, we've been through so many trials and tribulations. Now, where do you feel like you are in your gay journey?
Well, I feel like it's. Quote over, like, I'm just like, oh, I've accepted myself, I love it now, don't really think about it anymore. Like, I was, if you talked to me 2 weeks ago, I was just every day watching gay videos and YouTubers talking about it, but now I've got past that hump for like the 20th time in my life.
Sometimes I think we go in waves, because honestly, I don't watch a lot of gay YouTubers in general who make like gay content, but sometimes I get in a mood where I'm like, what are the gays doing?
Well, because there's this YouTuber who's doing a video on internalized homophobia, and she's like, at the time, I feel like she was like, there's not many people who actually talk about this, and I'm like, you're right, because I've been, like, researching, and there's nothing, but now there's a lot of videos. Like,
there is a lot now.
But internalized homophobia was just, I never thought I had it, but I really did. But it was also, like I said, a self-hate thing in general.
Mm-hmm.
So it was, like, a mix of just a bunch of hating myself, which is, like, completely gone, and don't think it'll ever come back. We'll see.
I think I might be too slutty. Because I've been thinking about whether or not I had internalized homophobia, but I think when you're as slutty as I am and sex-focused, you're like, fuck it, I'm getting laid. So, like,
yes,
your gayness becomes...
Yeah, and I'm not at all, so maybe when I find that side of myself, it'll, like, open up more or whatever.
Maybe. I don't know, because there are definitely... I started to think about, like, do I have to have... Because people say that all the time to me. Brittany, you're, like, internalized homophobia, blah, 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 blah.
Well, every time someone gives me a look or something, I think maybe, oh, they hate me for being gay. Or,
if the mood
is down, it's like, oh, it's because I sound gay and no one wants to talk.
Isn't that fear? Is that internalized homophobia? Oh, I guess maybe.
Paranoia?
Maybe.
Paranoid?
Yeah, see, I always had, like, I had thoughts of it as a teenager, like, oh my god, I'm gonna get, like, freaking fired.
But I wouldn't even talk. I a long time ago, I would never talk. Everyone knew me as the quiet guy.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't like my voice, but now I'm just like, yeah, whatever, I have a gay voice.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I can change it, but I'm not done now.
Yeah. No, I think that's fair. I don't know, I think these words are also too convoluted, and for me, there's, like, a much more nuance to these things. Being gay is such a personal issue. It's, like, such a personal journey, but we've made it the public's. We've allowed people to judge us for our gayness. We've allowed people, and including gay people. And I don't even mind being gay judged. I don't even care, as long as we can all have the conversation honestly. Because I've been told, like, even recently, my audience started to notice that I'm primarily talking about dating men. And they're like, oh my god, are you not dating women? And I'm like, no. And I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, do I have to come out about this?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not dating women right now, because I believe I choose who I fall in love with. And I don't think, like, oh, love just happens. I don't believe in that.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I'm looking at I told you guys, I'm half resume, half emotional when I date. So if we're not compatible, I want my life to be easy. I've worked too damn hard coming out and fighting for gay rights, and
mm-hmm.
now I want easy life, and it's easier for me to end up with a man, and since I don't have to pick, or I can pick, I'm good with that. Now,
see, that's the thing, I'm a little jealous, because
yeah.
I only like guys, and there are some girls I meet, I'm like, we hit it off, we have some chemistry, like, but if I wanted to fuck you, I'd ask you out.
Yeah.
Because we would hit it off, but
yeah.
I can't.
No, and that makes so
much
sense.
My options are so lowered.
But let me tell you this, I also know myself. If I found a girl that I really liked, I would fall in love, and then I'd fucking have to make that hard decision and be like, hey, mom and dad, so... So I'm just
so
going
to
avoid it.
So no one's going to your wedding.
So they're not coming to my wedding anyways.
Oh.
Because our parents don't go to non-Catholic weddings.
Oh.
So they're not coming to my wedding anyways.
Hmm.
You know, even if I do marry a man. But what I can do if I marry a man is, one, I have to get freaking major legal hoops getting children... But also, I can, you know, bring him around, which will be nice. So I'm making a decision. It's not permanent. It doesn't matter to me. Again, do not, you black and white thinkers out there, do not hear me say black and white things. Of course, I'll fall in love with a woman if I date a woman. But I believe
yeah.
it's a choice who you date. So I have a choice, so I'm, like, running the numbers. You know what I mean?
Really?
But you don't have that option.
No.
So it's going to be a battle.
It's very rare. But also, I'm not, I mean, it depends if I'm, like, in the city or not. Around a lot of gay people, but, I mean, even then, I felt like I was alone, but, because there's usually more straight people, even in this, like, the gay areas, I was, one or two gay people worked in the whole place,
mm-hmm.
I had.
So you're talking about me even meeting people, you're thinking about being single, like, just because of the statistics of meeting people? I mean, hopefully you meet more people. P.S. follow
yeah.
Mark on Instagram.
Oh, yeah.
He just made a public Instagram to, like,
yeah.
bring you guys over and make it safe, and so come on over.
But... I think it's a thing, like I said before, I haven't been around a lot of gay people,
mm.
so maybe I even am, like, internalized homophobia now, but I don't feel it, actually. Maybe I'm just in a shell still, and I don't know I am, but when I go out and meet people, then I'll, like, start to be... I've only been hanging out with my family for, like, a whole year.
I think everyone in COVID was
yeah,
basically hanging
so
out with their family
all
year.
That's why I'm, like, kind of lost myself a little bit and... like, became really secluded, and I haven't socialized in a while.
Well, that's the thing, too. So, I think that there is a stage in your life where you, like, really figure out if you're a city person, going to bars every day, or if you're a country person who
yeah,
visits.
Yeah, because I hated the city
mm-hmm.
when I was there too long, and now I miss it.
So, I don't miss the city, but I miss pride, I miss parties.
I miss the people. I've never even been
people.
To a party.
I miss but see, I don't want to make friends. I don't want to talk to anyone. See, that's the thing. I'm saying there is a time in your life where you recognize, like, I just want to go to a bar and dance with strangers who are never going to bother me again. Because,
wow,
like, I just like the energy of humans.
Yeah, that would be fun.
But I also went through the phase where, not phase, where a part of my life was so important for me to go out and socialize, to make friends, to meet everybody. I think it's so important you have that, and I don't think you got that.
Never.
You've been so busy fluctuating and going
places. Well, also, I've just been, you know, and I was also working, like, when we were in Seattle when I was young. So
that's what I'm saying. We didn't go out to
school,
traditional.
We just ran, and I worked at Walmart, like, till midnight, so I'm not, remember.
Listen, we didn't have that traditional, like, whatever college experience some kids get where they have summers off or some bullshit. Like, I don't even understand the concept of having a summer off.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what summer off are you going to have? I've been working since I was 12.
Yeah.
Like, what? So, yeah, we don't have, like, so we've had to decide, like, and also gays are, like, classes. So, it's like, what kind of gay are you hanging out with? Poor gays? Rich gays? Club gays? Yacht gays? Like, all these gays are different. Do you think it was cheap going to gay clubs every weekend?
Yeah, it's interesting.
Drinks were, like, $20 a shot where I was going.
Holy shit.
Oh, my God. And I would get a round of, like, fucking birthday sex for people, and it was just like...
Yikes.
Birthday sex? Sex on the beach? What is it called? Birthday sex? Is that what it's called? It's a shot.
I wouldn't know.
We got all the blowjob, like all these stupid shots, all named after fucking sex.
Well, I got
things.
Some of the best sushi roll sex on the beach.
What is vibrating? Is something vibrating?
Oh, my alarm.
Is it telling you to be gay?
Oh, I got interviewed a while, but I did it for the wrong day.
Oh, that's funny. Okay.
At this time.
So I think it's like a layer, though. I don't like the idea of saying, like, internalized homophobia. It's like saying racist to me. It's like, okay, everyone slow down.
Well, I feel like people are...
But own it if you feel it's accurate.
Internalized racism, too, on accident.
I think some people do, but I don't know if I believe in that as a human condition. Because, like,
oh,
the spiritual...
No?
Well, because, like, the spirituality of a human,
like... Disability or something?
The journey... Well, they make it sound like it's...
It's not a big... I mean,
it's not a big deal. That's
the
problem. They treat it, though, like, they say, like, ooh, like, that... feminine guy we watched with the nails was like, internalized homophobia?
Yeah.
Like, he was mad. I showed him on one of my videos,
guys. Oh, because he was saying, I think, like, he wants to go on a... He goes on a date with a guy, but he's insecure, but the guy won't like him because he's more feminine. So he will take off his long, colorful nails
right. For
the date. But I'm like, that's your problem, man. Like, you need to be okay,
like,
if you like having long
right. Nails,
you need to own your shit.
But he was like... The problem is, I don't blame him for having this thought process, because I think what he's ultimately saying...
I get it.
Is that, like, these are issues with himself, hopefully. But, you know, it doesn't...
Well, it sounded like he was blaming the world.
It did.
Which...
It did, which may be both. But that's the thing. Is he blaming mass men for not being interested in fem men? Because that sounds so weird to me. I'm attracted to what I'm attracted to, bro.
Yes. I don't think it's internalized homophobia for... Like, for me, for example, I do like more masculine men. But I don't think that... I think it's a preference. Because, I think it's homophobia when you see a flamboyant person and you think gross.
Yeah, like
but
you.
like Jonathan on Jonathan.
We love Jonathan.
Queer Eye, or Bobby, whatever. I would look at them a long time ago and be like, oh, like you're annoying, you're gross. But I fucking love them now because I was being homophobic
yes. Before.
But that doesn't mean I'll think they're attractive now.
Exactly.
I mean, I could make out with Jonathan now and like be like, oh, that's fun as a friend or something.
But, like,
but I would not be repulsed like I would before. I'd
yeah.
be like, oh, you're too flamboyant.
Well, here's the problem. You know what I've realized? I've been verbalizing it more. I don't know if you guys have noticed. I'm attracted to basically any kind of human, period. But I could not live a long life attraction level
yes.
with them for long term.
Yeah.
Because certain parts of my brain are like, feminine guys with nails and like girls' underwear are so hot to me. But that 24/7, no.
Mm.
I
yeah.
can't, like, 24/7, like, no, I need masculine energy in my life,
yeah.
please.
Yeah.
And, like, even in my women, like, I could not date a girly girl with, like, fake nails and pounds of makeup, like, LA girls, like, ugh, boring.
Yeah.
And I love makeup, I like queer makeup, though, and even then, queer people, like, the James Charles part of the YouTube, gay part,
I
can't.
I don't even.
It's too gay, it's, like, not too gay, it's too feminine, it's too girly, it's too high maintenance, it's
$100.
James Charles is talking about hundreds of dollars for his fucking nails, and I'm just thinking, like, my bank account is not going to support your habit.
Yeah, no.
I can't.
Sometimes too much of anything, though, is just too,
exactly.
Too much.
Too much of anything. I
like
big balance.
Even
big balance.
Queer Eye, watching that show, it was too much, so I had to watch a slower-paced show like Star Trek, because it was just too much noise and too fast-paced, which, you know,
yeah.
that's the point of the show. They want you to be, like, extra stimulated or something from all the things happening?
No, absolutely. So I think
yeah.
overall, the reason we wanted to make sure that we just
balance.
Talked.
There needs to be a balance.
There needs to be a balance in your life, you know, no matter who you are or what you're doing. And if you're a person who's like a eccentric embracer of like loudness, which, you know, I'm all about, just own it and realize that that's you. Okay, first of all.
Because like I said, when I lived here, we didn't get along, but now we love each other. I do love her because... Like, right now, I always want to hang out with Brittany because I don't live with her anymore. But, like, when I'm having too much Brittany, I'm like, I need a break.
Which I think is so valid, but that's a problem. People are like, authentically accept every part of me. Accept me at all points.
No.
And I'm like, how about I just accept you in increments?
Yeah, but the fuck? Even our, like, own parents, I accept them in increments, too, because...
Our parents
that's
do.
What
like,
do.
What did I tell you guys? I can hang out 2 weeks tops with my folks before I'm like, fight.
So hard.
It is hard, you know what I mean? Because we're so different.
Yeah.
And why shouldn't we be? Look, I have brothers who come to me all the time and go, you're so fucking loud. And I'm like, you're so fucking loud. And like, that's the thing. I'm very loud, which is why I tell you every year I'm...
Well, we all are a little bit.
Well, and every year I get more comfortable and like... my choices. Every year I'm like, oh yeah, that's just how it is. And that way
Sorry.
I can better communicate it to people too. Because I'm pretty consistent. I'm pretty consistently loud.
Yeah, but like I like loud people all mm-hmm. the time. I want to talk to someone who's really talkative sometimes.
Well, our whole family's talkative,
yeah.
So that probably is also comfortable for you. A lot of people might feel like I'm on a couple of dates, you know, online with these guys, and one guy, he's like, I come from a really quiet family with one other sibling. I'm
nope.
gonna be honest, like
yikes, I don't
even know how this would work. And I'm like, yeah, that's okay.
No.
You know, and okay, I have a question though. I've been telling people I want to, like, a man who's masculine but has, like, gay energy. What do you think that means?
I mean, is Bobby on Queer Eye an example for me? I think Bobby's really attractive because he has that balance I like because he looks masculine.
Yeah, but he's a little feminine.
He has, yeah, he does. Well, he has a very,
I want someone
he's
a little rougher though. They're all
like
kind of city boys.
Yeah.
Even though he grew up on a farm, right? Isn't he the country boy? I can't remember.
I think so. I don't remember.
It's like, I want to balance, like me, like, I feel like I'm masculine but feminine, but I'm not too girly and I'm not too manly.
What am I? I think I'm in the middle.
Yeah, we fall, I think everyone in our family falls in the middle.
Huh.
Like, you know, he was like, I'm like a log cabin guy. I'm like, you're a city boy.
Yeah, trash. You don't want to stay in your car, get it cleaned all the time, and then you're... Never mind.
Yeah, it's so funny. Isn't that funny? Like, the way that people see themselves
yeah.
is so funny. But I do. Even dad, though, I tell people he's like romantic to mom, but he's not overly romantic. He's not, like, making out with mom in the kitchen.
Well,
their
I've only seen them touch lips once in my life because that's an accident because I peeked in the bedroom. Well, mom was just laying down, and I think dad kissed her on the forehead or something. I was like, porn!
Sweet! Oh my gosh, so sweet. But, like, our dad's a masculine man. But, like, dad isn't, like, one of those guys who's like, I have balls on my truck, and blah, 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 blah.
He's not an insecure, like,
he's not
tiny,
an insecure.
Tiny dick syndrome.
He doesn't have tiny dick syndrome, you know? And I think that's what's key. Even when you're gay, you cannot have fag insecurity syndrome or something. Or, like, you know, like, the opposite of tiny dick is, like, oh, I'm not gay enough, so I have to be extra gay. Or I'm not, like, you know what I mean?
See, I did feel like a point, like, I'm not straight enough, I'm not gay enough, but I'm not straight at all.
I think that's so normal, though. I think that's, like, the crisis of the gay.
But... Yeah, I mean, I realized a while ago, like, okay, fuck it. Because I told you, like, a few years ago when I got my job and people, first day, didn't even ask my name, just asked me if I'm gay.
That was Seattle, right?
No, that too. It did happen there. I swear, it fucking
mm-hmm.
happens every job. Because I sound gay, but I don't look gay all the time. And,
but everyone, okay, look.
But they're so curious.
Do you think we should live in a world where people aren't allowed to ask those questions? Or do you want the option to ask it, but the option to say none of your business?
I feel like... Can you just, like, maybe ask it privately, not in front of everybody? I don't care if you do that. Like,
yeah, because there is an issue with this obsession of gayness where, like, in Seattle, it's, like, the first things, like, hey, gay, straight, bi, what are we into?
Like, yeah,
and I'm like,
I got a job there, and this person just, my coworker, ran up to me super excited, didn't ask my name or say hi, and he's like, I have to know, guys or girls. And I was just like, okay, interesting.
Yeah, it's like people's obsession is so interesting. You look so tiny on screen right now. I'm sorry. You look like a kid, and I'm like this tall giant right now. My feet are completely numb.
It's because my
yeah.
Blood
here,
flow.
Ready? Look at our old ass genetics here.
I'm like 22 and dying.
And dying, I'm dying. Okay. Oh.
Okay, now you're so short.
Well, because I stretched out my legs.
But I. Okay.
It's fine. We'll work
you're
it out.
You're just uneven though.
But yeah, I don't know, I like the idea of people being very comfortable, like, we're so safe that a gay man can run up to a total stranger without understanding. Mark could have been a hateful homophobe, but this man just walks right up to him and be like, boys or girls? And he's like, what if Mark was like, neither, because I'm taking a vow of celibacy, you know?
Or
some bullshit. Or
I'm asexual or something.
Yeah, or, well, asexual, like, that's not how I think. Like, do you get what I'm saying? And I'm not even mad at humans for doing this, because it's just so human. But this is why I love diversity, because it's chaotic. You never know what's going to happen. And that's the problem, is, like, it's kind of nice to live in a bubble out here where we're kind of safe.
The only reason, like, I don't think, like, I wouldn't have everything in my house be gay, 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 gay. But it is, it's like, being part of the community feels pretty good. You're part of a YouTube community. I'm sure that feels kind of good. You have a little YouTube family. So people have religions. Like, I don't have anything. So it's like, what are you? Are you a woman? So then you have other women to, like, relate to. I'm gay, so I relate to other gay people who know what it's like to, like, kind of try to hide yourself. And it's kind of interesting to have that connection with someone because, you know, some people just don't know what it's like to be hated for no reason by a stranger because of you're wearing pink and they know you're gay now and they hate you. It feels pretty shitty, actually, like, especially back then when I really cared about what strangers thought. But it's like, for no reason, like, just for me being here, I'm like, hated, so it feels kind of odd. So I get it when you are with those people who understand that feeling. It feels non-judgy.
Yeah, you feel great, which is why it's so hurtful when, like, gay communities then reject you for your beliefs, because it's like, oh my god, I'm being rejected again.
Yeah.
It's like, what the fuck? Or
people would say, like, Anthony, I was seeing someone online, they were making a joke how he, about, like, homophobia, kind of, like, how he feels about it. It was actually an episode, I think. I no one said this, but I feel like people might say he has internalized homophobia because he is more straight. He's the straight one of the group. That's the joke they make. But he made a point, like, no, like, I'm a cook. I love the beach. I do all this stuff. I just didn't think fashion, all I look for in fashion is, like, good-fitting jeans and a t-shirt.
Oh, sounds like such a chef.
But,
like, what chefs are well-dressed? I never think about the fashion of a chef.
Yeah.
I always think of their food, so it makes sense that he put more effort into that. Plus, he's gorgeous by natural, so, like, he doesn't even have to try.
Oh, yeah, I know, right?
And they could wear a trash bag, and I'd be like, would 10 out of 10. Like,
yeah,
gorge.
Yeah, he really is. But it's kind of like that transgender episode the guy had after Bobby redid the whole house, and he just kept a little bit of queerness in there, along with a bunch of other stuff about this guy's personality.
Ah!
He loved it so much more at the end. He's like, wow, so people can still walk in, because he takes in a lot of, the transgender guy takes in a lot of, like, people off the street or friends to let them know we're welcome, and this queer people are welcome here. So there is a little queer spaces on the wall, but not everywhere. Just so people still know, like, oh, this is a queer-friendly house. That's perfect. Just a little bit of a, little bit, a touch of queerness, a little touch of everything else in his life.
I went to a lesbian's home once. And she's obsessed with vagina art, and everything from her fans to the entryway to the art was just all vulva, vagina, clitoris, labia. It was just everywhere. And you know what's so weird is she did make it classy, where I was like, okay, like, elite liberal weirdos would think this was really decorative and I like it. But not functional.
I don't know if it's people might say, I don't know, it's internalized homophobia that I don't care for a lot of sexual things, but that's because I like sex to be private. I do.
I think sex is private.
That's probably just how we were raised, but it's like, nudity, that's different.
No, okay.
Nudity's different, but like sex, like that transgender episode, he did have like literally just people fucking on the wall. Like,
oh, like
straight
yeah, see, okay.
And I was like, interesting.
Like, we're not, okay, there's the Andy Warhol part of, like, liberal thought processes, which is, like, sex should be everywhere, and it's really, like, pornish, and I just think a little, what's the word I want? Crude. Mm-hmm. It's just, like, crude.
Yeah,
it's not classy. As I get older, I want a more classy environment.
Also, I'm just so sick of the hookup culture, like.
Yeah,
I'm
think
sorry.
Everyone's sick of hookup culture.
Well, I'm sorry, but, like, people have blocked me on Grindr because, I say Grindr, I don't use it anymore, but Grindr, people block me because I say I want to meet them first before getting into anything sexual, and they block me. They're like, no, we want to hook up right now. How can you not? And I'm just like,
we're dogs,
what the
man.
Fuck, dude?
Where'd all the demisexuals go?
In their bio, looking for true love. I'm like, what the fuck?
That's what I'm saying. I do not, these online dating apps.
I bet. I haven't had sex yet all the way, but I feel like sex would be way fucking better if you got to know someone first and you started feeling the feelings for each other instead of just like physical attraction off the bat. I feel like it'll feel so much better when you know. I've never kissed someone I've known more than like a minute off grind.
Look, this is what I'm saying though. I'm saying, see, okay, in my head, I'm like, oh, you
can
buy.
I think that's a tangent. But what?
That was great. I was like, no, that was great.
Oh.
I would think that you would go well with like the sex positive circles that are focused on hookup culture as much, but even those circles are all hookup culture unless you're hanging
Why?
Out with the demisexual asexuals.
Because some guys are so, like, I'm like, wow, I'm actually an attractive person on an app. Like, hey, let's hit it off. And then they just want to fuck. And I'm like, damn it.
Yeah, like, why do you have to go straight there? I think a big part of it is because, like, some people are just like, that's why I'm saying, if your identity is, like, who you're fucking instead of who you're building relationships with, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying being gay can be about who you're fucking, and that's fine. Mm-hmm. Like, I love city, dark, like, gay clubs where everyone's just fucking in the corners. Yikes. Love it.
I would be so intimidated.
Love it. But is that my mood all the time? No. Most of the time it's kids and, like, families and, like, you want to be a dad. Mm-hmm. You want to have a family.
That would be fucking awesome.
You know, how many gay
might
people
not happen.
How many gay people you know who want to raise families?
I don't know any that I've...
I don't know any. Most of my friends are not even going to have children. Most of my hetero friends are not having children. Mm-hmm. They're not choosing to be family people. I want a family.
It's really expensive to adopt.
So the energy that we're bringing into our lives, that family energy, isn't even found in this generation yet. I know straights are struggling, gays are struggling, family people are struggling.
Yeah, I feel that.
There's 100%. A struggle.
But it's like, I'm not even looking for someone who wants a family. I'm looking for like a date with like a...
I know, but ultimately...
I'm literally looking for a date with just, like, a person who's themselves, and we just have fun. I don't want to... I don't even know if I want to make out with someone before even getting to know them, usually. Like, Anthony, I knew I want to make out with him right away.
Everyone wants to make out with Anthony.
But, like I said, Bobby. I did not think Bobby's attractive. I didn't even notice him, and now I think he's super freaking hot. So,
well, I mean, that's how
it just takes a minute for me, for a lot of people.
I just told them it takes me 6 months to decide if I even really like a
dude,
person.
Dude, okay, so even coworkers I've had that I just didn't even care about, it took, like... months, and then all of a sudden I'm like, you're the hottest person in the world.
Because you get to know them and you humanize them, and then you're like, oh.
Also from photos, I don't know how y'all tell people are attractive, because do you not need to see their height and their mannerisms
and
their voice? Their voice especially.
I can tell you this. I know if people are attractive when I see them right away, but whether or not I'm attracted to them long term, I have to get to know you. But you can't get more attractive to me over time.
I was going
to
say.
Or less attractive.
Okay, yes,
because if Anthony was an asshole, he'd be ugly as hell.
But his personality
is so
good.
I could find every flaw in Anthony's face if I wanted to.
Yeah.
He's lucky he's a peach.
Yeah. I was going to say something, but I forgot.
Oops.
No.
My bad.
That's my brain. Oh, I was just going to say about finding people attractive. Like Bobby, there's potential, but there's no sexual feeling. So I know when there's potential to think they're attractive.
Yes!
But, like, sometimes it just doesn't click. I don't even want to kiss them or anything. And then I talk to them and get to know them, and I'm like, or
yes.
It's a big no.
Yes.
So, yeah. But Anthony just had it off the bat. He's just a generally attractive person.
Yeah.
But now I think Bobby's more attractive than he is.
Mm-hmm. Like, I think you're a genuinely attractive person, too. Like, when
Thanks.
People see you,
yeah.
They're thinking, oh, attractive. I don't think your issue is finding...
It's the bone structure, I think.
It is. I don't think your issue is, like, finding guys who are attracted to you. It's finding the right guys you want to be attracted to, too.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah, which feels weird, because I never saw myself as an attractive person, but, you know, when you log on to an app and, like, just get blown up with all these... disgusting guys, and I don't think any of them are attractive. I'm just like...
You're, like, disgusting.
Well, they are, and especially when you just...
They're so crude. That's the problem.
It is,
like,
just sending... My profile, like, if it says you don't want nudes, people are just still gonna fucking send you their dick first picture, and it's just like...
Ew, why do they love it? They're such monkeys. But
like
they're such animals.
Can I just say something about dicks, please? Like, I just don't think a dick is hot, okay? Like, by itself, what the fuck? Guys can see a vagina, they're like, damn, I'm like, no, whose body's attached to that?
Oh my god.
Whose face, whose mannerisms are attached to that? Because it's just a nasty,
cool
thing.
Can I tell you this right now? When men send me comments saying, Mark, cover your ears. When they send me comments saying, I want to lick your wet pussy, all I want to do is, like, never have sex again. It's just, okay, you can stop. When you talk lover talk or do lover things with non-lovers, it's such a turn off to me.
I hate that.
It's such a turn
off.
Like,
this guy was just talking to her on an app, I've never been in a relationship, so being called babe was very uncomfortable for me, but he just called me baby and love and all this stuff, and I was very like,
I'm sorry, do I know you like that?
I told him I don't like being called babe right now, because maybe that's awkward when you're first time in talking to someone, and he just like kept doing it and said, he's like, no, just play pretend, and then you'll get used to it. I'm like, pretend?
That's
crazy. The fuck? Play pretend to get used to it? If I'm not used to it, why am I...
No, that is crazy to me. Like, that... But that's the problem. People are not dating you. They're dating the idea of you. They're trying to fill time. They're lonely.
Because, yeah, and the same guy, like, knew nothing about me, but he was like, you're my dream guy. You're perfect. Blah, blah, blah. And I was so turned off because I'm like, I want those words to be said to me by someone who we actually love each other.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. No, that's it right there, is that the objectification isn't only just sexually, like, saying, ooh, that person's hot, I'm gonna fuck them. It's also engaging with people emotionally under false pretenses, telling people that, like, you like them for who they are when you've known them 2 months. You don't know who that person is.
Not even a little bit.
You don't even know who that person is. But now we're in validation culture right now, where everyone feels the need to get validated, and I did need that at a time in my life, but when I realized the validations were also fake, I was like, this feels worse than being told I was, like, awful. I'd rather be rejected than fake validated.
Yeah, agreed.
Because at least if they reject me, I know, like, where they stand, but if they fake validate...
But part of me feels like they don't even know themselves, so...
I don't think they're doing it maliciously.
Yes.
I don't think... The same thing, I don't think homophobes are... They don't know they're being malicious. Like, I see them, they're like, I'm trying to save you. I'm like, you're doing a bad job.
Yeah, horrible.
Some are malicious, and just, like, some are maliciously validating you, like, fake bitches, right? Mm-hmm. Fake woke people. Mm-hmm. But, like, real, genuine people who think they're, like... I want people to all know they're loved. It's like, all of us are loved. The pedophiles are loved. The racists are loved. Yeah. Is everybody loved?
Shut the fuck up.
It's like, why do you say that? Why do you say everyone should be loved? Loved by who? Loved by all of us? Or just loved by their people? Mm-hmm. Like, maybe.
I will say, I'm happy I haven't dated before, because now I found out who I am. If I started to date when I wanted to date, when I wanted true love and all that
stuff. You would end up in a 5-year marriage, or a relationship with some shitty person like I did.
But now I'm like, wow, like, I want a family and stuff, but, like, if I don't get it, I'm gonna have a badass life still. Like,
totally.
But, like, if I do, cherry on top, you know? But, like...
Cherry on top.
Man, it's just such a different thought process. When I was a kid, I think I... Because I felt lonely in the family, so I wanted, like, a lover or something.
Totally.
But now I'm just like...
That's the thing, too. I meet too many people who are like, I want to have kids so I don't grow old alone. I want to have a partner so I don't die alone.
Or people are like, I'm 30. I have to look on the street and see all my options. Like,
and for me, I'm just like, it'd be really cool to meet someone that I bond with. But otherwise, like, I wouldn't allow someone into my space, can you imagine a stranger in my house, Mark, at this time in my life?
No.
Can you imagine me just bringing random people home, like, who I don't vibe with? Like,
yeah, right.
How?
Impossible.
No.
Mm-mm. No, I'm over it.
No, over it. I just, like, it's a young person's game. I'm too old. My knees hurt.
My feet are hurting again.
Everything hurts.
Wait, my foot's asleep.
But we have to wrap it up anyways, because I got a call to do in 5 minutes. Guys, thank you so much for being here and having this casual conversation of queerness with us at the end of Pride Month. Happy June. Happy Pride. Enjoy the celebrations. Pride will happen throughout the year, of course. Go to your local Pride parade and have some fucking fun after this quarantine.
Yeah, just
let's have some fucking fun.
Like, dress colorful and yell. Freaking scream to the top of your lungs if you want to.
Let's
That's
go.
All I want.
I'm
some,
ready.
Have some fun.
I'm ready. This year is going to be great. All right, guys. Talk to you soon.
Bye.
Bye. Perfecto, mon ami. Oh my god, my old legs.
My feet, my ankles.
Crossed. I think I broke something.
Oh.
My knees are going.